So Dr. Jon Cash has taught students with disabilities at many different levels. He started his journey as a special education teacher in a junior high school in Mississippi. From there, he spent several years as a consultant with schools in Mississippi, Alabama, and Tennessee, where he worked with teachers to help students with disabilities make progress in their classrooms. Dr. Cash earned his PhD in curriculum and instruction from a concentration in special education from Mississippi State University. Dr. Cash is also the father of a student with autism, mild cerebral palsy, and spina bifida. His research interests include autism, students with special needs, and drug use, and the social justice responsibilities of schools towards students with disabilities. So without further ado, Dr. Jon Cash.
I'm not used to that. Okay, like Mary said, my son is actually here today. I don't have many props, so I just have to bring him along. So that's Toby. Toby's come a long way. Toby never had a program like this. We're from Mississippi, which is certainly much different from Massachusetts. It's not that we don't have services, we just don't have a lot of services. And we certainly don't have anything like the CPDC. So I've been introduced to you, so I'm just gonna jump right in. This is my plan for the day. I want to communicate respect and recognition. There are a lot of you that know a lot more about what you do than I do. Okay, so I don't have expertise in what you do. So I want to recognize that. You know a lot more about what you do. And there are a lot of people who are already doing stuff that I'm gonna talk about. A lot of you already have a lot of these skills. You may not be able to voice what these skills are, but you have them. And the first skill to have, of course, is empathy. And I know that, I don't know how many of you are, because it would take too long to count you, but I'm talking with a group of students here that have a lot of empathy. Of course, empathy is the first order of business, not sympathy. And that's kind of what we're going to talk about today, how to have empathy, but how to get students with special needs to achieve. Because regardless of what you do, that's what we all do, right? So I'm gonna provide you with some practical approaches to supporting individuals in the development of what's called self-regulation, which you may not realize what you're doing is helping children with disabilities learn how to self-regulate. And that's a very important skill for a child with a disability to have, because so many of them struggle with this idea of self-regulation. A lot of them don't even know what it is. So also I'm gonna ask your questions and help you with real situations that you provide toward the end when we ask questions. So, I forgot my clicker. I have my clicker. I can walk around with my clicker. All right, so what's your job in this presentation? Well, you have to slow me down if I'm talking too fast. I don't talk very fast. I'm from the South, okay? So you should be able to hear every word that I say, because I usually put in a lot more syllables than you guys do. I have an older son named Tim, and shortly after we moved up here, we went to get a haircut, and the receptionist at the place where we're getting our haircut asked us our names, and they said, what's his name? Pointed to my oldest son, and I said Tim, and she wrote T-I-U-M. T-O. So anyway, so if you have cell phones, this is from a previous presentation, but if you have cell phones, please put them on buzz. I don't even know if you have them. If you think about how you can apply this stuff in your lives and work, because I know many of you want to go on and work with children with special needs for the rest of your life. And I promise you, there's nothing more emotionally rewarding for you than what you're gonna choose to do. Now, it's probably not gonna be very financially rewarding, so just get ready for that. And you're gonna have to walk around for the rest of your life with people telling you how special you are. And that's okay. You'll get sick of hearing it, though. Because, you know, I mean, we are special people. There's no doubt about that. I'm not trying to take that away from you. But at the same time, what we do is work. And if children are gonna make progress, it's very hard work. There's nothing easy about it. So I want you to make plans for creating and participating in the development of this stuff in your places. And what I mean by that is not just where you are now, but where you might want to be. Does that make sense? Because I'm not bragging, there's pretty good stuff in here. All right, so without that, this is a first thing you have to do when you're working with students with special needs, is you have to be very flexible. Has anybody encountered that? That, you know, you've been told what to do with a student, and somebody has told you, and you may have a plan. You know, I think I was talking with Mary, and you're working off case studies, and somebody's impression, you know, you get this impression of this student, and then you actually start working with this student, and what you're doing may not be working, or you can tell that the student is not doing quite as much as they possibly could do. That's okay. What you can't do is have a very rigid idea of what you want to accomplish with a student. And I'm going to explain that further as we go on. But most of it is realizing that there is much more than one approach with every individual student that you need to be able to employ. Some of these approaches don't occur in a textbook. People can't tell you about them. They come from the relationship that you have personally with the student that you work with. So, has anybody over here ever done models? Like you put together model cars? That's kind of more probably my generation than your generation. But did anybody ever collect action figures or dolls or anything like that? Well, those things really, after a while, just kind of sit on the shelf and collect dust. Well, that's the same way that models of working with students with disabilities, models sit and collect dust. So what you have to be is you have to have a flexible mind and not just get yourself into one mindset or one model that this is the way this works and it works with all students. The only thing that works with all students is your ability to form a relationship with every student that you teach. And that relationship is going to dictate the progress that your student makes. It's not the model, it's not how much you know, it's not how much the student can do. Because you'll never get the full potential of a child. You just won't. Because that child has to determine that for himself. That child has to self-regulate before they're ever able to self-actualize. Does that make sense? And even this applies to every human being. Not just people who can achieve a lot, like you guys, right? You guys can achieve a lot. And it's really easy for you guys to achieve compared to some of the students that you may work with. But that doesn't mean they don't have that desire in their heart to do something more tomorrow than they're doing today. So, don't fall in love with a particular approach. Ideally, you'll create a framework for intervention, a working theory that will evolve with experience and evidence, and it will be child-centered. Does that make sense? Is everybody following me so far? Am I talking too fast? Okay. Am I talking too slow? Okay. All right. So, rules for success. The smart guys are the guys who learn from the other guys. Don't get caught up in one thing. Everyone believes their thing is the best thing, and they're usually wrong, so shut up and listen, learn, and change. In order to be successful, you've got to be eclectic. And what that means is that if you're working with a student, okay, and you may think you're making great progress until you talk with someone else. You have to be, this idea of the flexible mind is even though you're one-on-one with a student, right? Is that correct? Y'all have to help me because I've never seen what you do. Remember, you guys know more about what you do than I know about what you do. So if you work one-on-one with a student, that doesn't mean that you're the only person in that, or even around here in that child's life, that can help that child make progress. There are others. Your peers, the people that you work with, people like Sheila, people the leaders like Mary, you need their input. Because without their input, these children are not going to make the progress that you would like them to see. Is everybody on board with that? Okay. So in order to be successful, you've got to be eclectic. Does anybody know what eclectic means? Graham's like, no, man. Has anybody ever heard the word eclectic before? Eclectic is when you take a little piece of this, 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 and you kind of form it into whatever it is you're doing. It's a little piece of everything. It's eclectic. Does that make sense? Good? Okay. All right. So, here's some common questions that you might encounter when you're working with students with disabilities. How much of this behavior or limitation is due to disability anyway? So have you ever asked yourself this? I mean, when you're working with a student, you're kind of afraid to push them because you don't really understand how much their disability really affects them. Well, the answer to that is how many angels can dance on the head of a pin? Anybody know the answer to that? No. Nobody knows what somebody can achieve. Nobody knows what somebody can achieve. With my son Toby, and I know I'm driving the cameraman crazy. I'm moving. I hope he's going to be okay. I move around a lot. With Toby, we were told when we adopted him that he probably would never walk straight. We told there was a chance he would never talk. Did you know that, Toby?
No.
You see, he can talk fire. He does. So, you know, that was really scary. That was really scary for a long time for us. In fact, I used to dream that that Toby was going downstairs calling his big brother. So you can't say, I'm sorry, every now and then I get a little emotional. You can't say that you know what a child can do or can't do. And never, ever assume a student can't do something. Now, by the same token, what you're doing with these students is physical. You don't want to hurt them. So you have to use very good judgment. But not just your judgment. You remember, you have to be eclectic. You have to be flexible. It's not just your judgment you should count on. Collectively, it's everybody's judgment. And whenever you have questions, you cannot be afraid to ask. Hey, and even if it's somebody sitting beside you, you know, look, we're doing this. What do you think? You'll be surprised at how much information even your peers that are in a similar context, a similar situation, can give you that will help your student make progress. So, but it's impossible to know what a person with a disability can do. Does anybody know the Helen Keller story? That's kind of the common fallback. Every person who's ever talked about disability, we all talk about Helen Keller, right? Well, and now Toby was much more fortunate than Helen Keller was, because he was born at a time when there's a lot of therapy. There's a lot of people like you who go on to be PTs, OTs, speech pathologists, special educators. But when she came up, she couldn't talk, she couldn't see, right? She couldn't hear. And think about all the things that she accomplished. And if you don't know what Helen Keller accomplished, you need to Google her and read up about her, especially if you work with children with special needs, because she was what taught us what is possible. She's the one that taught us what is possible. So the issues confronting the individual with brain dysfunction are a combination of environmental factors, pre-injury history, if they're dealing with traumatic brain injury, the site of the injury or the site of the disability, how the disability affects their brain, the severity of the injury, right? Or how disability manifests itself in the individual. Because you can have two children and they can have autism and they're not going to do two things the exact same way. Same thing with Down syndrome, same thing with cerebral palsy. Same thing with any disability. It is not just because a child has we have categorized a child, that does not mean that that child fits perfectly into any category. So we have to keep that in mind. You know, you try, we have to label people, right? Some of us are black, some of us are white, some of us are Hispanic. You know, some of us are 22, some of us are 29. Some of us are between the ages of 40 and 50. You know what I mean? We have to label people. But you can't let that label, when you're working with a student, You can't let that label limit what you think that student can do. Because remember, we don't know what that student can do. That student doesn't know what that student can do. You don't know what your limitations are. In fact, if you don't believe you have any limitations, you probably don't. Does that make sense? All right. So, that last slide didn't apply. So when, that's not the plot. All right, so is there a standard for therapy? Is there a standard for what you should be doing? Do you guys have standards? Can somebody help me? Do you have standards? Yes?
Activities have to be safe.
Have to be safe, okay.
The person has to be successful. To a range, like if the person, if you're doing, taking a basketball shot 10 times, if two times making it isn't good, you want to kind of have at least like five or six so that the person's actually succeeding.
Okay,
because
all right.
If you're setting someone up to fail, they're not going to want to continue doing it.
Right. So, but there's no standard for what somebody could accomplish. Does that make sense? Now, what you're saying is, I'm not arguing with you. Please don't think I'm arguing with you. So you want them to make, if they're doing 10 shots, and they can only make two, how do you determine whether they go forward?
But the outcome of their response. If they're still jumping up and down and happy, probably continue.
Okay. All right. Very good. Excellent. So obviously you've gotten some really good training already from somewhere because you've learned to read when your student feels like they have success or when they want to continue. Okay. Is everybody coming to talk something similar to that? Yeah. So, but you have to remember there is no standard, and there's no clear way to help a student with special needs. So, if you know there's a limit to what we can do in our own context, but at the same time, you may be the most important, the most influential person in this child's life. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, you know, there's all kind of different ways we can talk about helping students with disabilities. You know, there's an increasing evidence that when interventions are done in context, many approaches that are used with other populations are also effective with other individuals, but we don't know because what is it based on? What do we base what we do on? Remember, we don't really have a set standard. What's your name?
David.
So when we don't have a set standard, what is it that David is talking about? I think I'm losing everybody here for a second. Am I losing everybody sitting? Okay. When you're not sure what to do, and you go back to what it is you think you ought to do, and there is no standard, how do you make progress? What do we base progress on? Always.
Practice.
But we base it on what that student can do. Does that make sense? It always comes back to what your student can do. That's how you become so powerful in this student's life. Simply because you may be the most influential person in the world, because cognitive therapy is what we kind of think about when we work with students with disabilities, behavioral therapy, to try to get them to behave a certain way. We have peak physical therapy, we have occupational therapy, we have speech therapy, and all of these things work, but they may not work as well as what you as an individual do with this student. You should feel very powerful with this student. You should know that everything that you're doing is going to help this student. Does that make sense? So, and there's some things that we do with students with special needs, The reason I put this in here is this is something that I do. I do social skills training a lot, but there's no real hard evidence that social skills training works. Just like there's no real, you know, it's really hard to get good evidence that a child who's able to make a basket is somehow going to be more successful in life. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
But, can you imagine that child never getting the opportunity to make that basket? Somebody has to help that child provide that opportunity. So, when we talk about things, if you run into behavior, I always tell, especially younger practitioners this, one question that often comes up is you think your child needs, you know, the child that you work with needs to be medicated. You know, you start thinking about medication. And I want to caution people that medication is not always effective with all children. And you shouldn't let that be something you automatically go to. Does that make sense? Does anybody in here have challenging behavior with their student that you've encountered challenging? You have? Really? Oh, I'm sorry. My son said he had encountered some challenging behavior. You have challenging behavior. I'm sorry. You were in my direct line of sight. No, how many, are you experiencing challenging behavior with the student that you work with? Yeah. Well, okay, that's common. You're asking students with disabilities to do something. You may be the only person in this child's life that is asking this child to do something. Parents don't always ask the children with special needs to do a whole lot. They have a lot of sympathy. Special ed teachers may not be challenging this student. You may be the only person in this student's life that are actually challenging them. So if you're getting behavior from a student when you're asking them to do something physical, when nobody else in the world is asking them to do anything, you have to expect that. You have to expect some challenges. So, but don't let the first thing that you go to be, man, this cat needs to be more medicated. That's not what helps. All the medication can do is kind of alter the chemicals in the brain, but a lot of times the way the medications alter the chemicals is not conducive to the child wanting to do anything. So don't let that be the first thing that you go to. So while there are common traits, everyone's brain manifests itself differently. So every intervention strategy will need to be tailored to address these individual differences. I know that's kind of what you do anyway, right? So how do we get to this point to where we're doing, your name is Grace, your name is Jill, you have name tags. Oh, well, that's convenient. You didn't have one. Huh? I wouldn't have been able to read it from way back here anyway. So Grace, how do we get to this point to where we're working with this individual student, right? And this student may be giving us some behavior. How do we know whether or not the behavior comes from what they can do or what they can't do?
No.
Okay, you don't. So how do you solve this puzzle without compromising on the first thing that, what's your name again?
David.
That David said, which is to be
safe.
Be safe. So how do we do that? No ideas? I'm sorry, you're just right up here up front.
You have to test it out.
Okay, so how do you do it? So when you say test the waters, what do you mean?
You like push them just enough to see where they want to go and where it's
okay.
Too far.
All right. So whatever we do, it's individualized, right? We don't have a set prescription because we're eclectic people. We're flexible. What if you don't seem to be getting any progress? Or you something that you think the student would find, you may move to somebody else.
Sure.
Okay, Jill.
All
right, so what do we do when we see a student that looks like they're not enjoying something?
you could move to like a different type of activity that focuses on what you were focusing in that, like that specific activity. Try it, maybe adapt it to a different one that they may like better.
Okay. All right. So once we see, once we perceive that they're not liking an activity that we're doing, we can just change, right?
You can try to change. Some kids may not like change. They may want to stick with it even though they don't like it.
Okay. Because it's hard for them to transition.
Yeah.
Okay. So when we get a student to transition and they don't like something, and then we transition again and they don't like something, what we want to be sure we're watching for is, are they trying to
tell you something?
Huh?
Are they trying to tell you something? Like,
well, they're trying to tell you something, but what we want to be careful of is they're trying to control their own output. Who should be in control of their output?
I think this is what we talk about when we do, like, instead of saying, do you want to do this, and leave them with the yes, no option, you say, first we're going to do this, and then we're going to do that.
So yes.
You're trying to, like,
and when you do that, you're setting up what's called a contingency. I mean, Toby was telling Mary up here earlier, what do you have to do before you can do YouTube?
Do my homework.
So first you do this, then you do this. That's a very powerful way of getting compliance from a student. So once again, you know more about what you do than I know about what you do, but what you don't want to do is let a student decide how much output they're going to give you. Now, the first thing you have to do is be safe, okay? So you don't want to put this child in any danger, but at the same time, we want to be very careful of what's called learned helplessness. Does anybody know what, can somebody tell me what learned helplessness is?
That's someone that I'm taking care of, that she's learned, she knows how to make her lunch.
Yeah.
But she's learned most staff, if you go up and ask them, go, can you make my lunch?
Ah.
They'll make it, she doesn't have to make lunch.
Sure.
So what I've gone to is I wrote it down that you can make your own lunch.
Yes.
Because that's something that she should be able to do, and that's something that she's able to, but she's trying to see how much she can get you.
What's the problem with that?
You're not promoting as much independence as the person has.
And two, it's easy for somebody who, it's easy for people who are employing sympathy to really want to help people. Because that's what you're here to do, right? Is anybody here not to help people? If you're here not to help people, raise your hand. Okay, we're all here to help people, right? But we have a little bit different mission than being a maid or being a helper. What are we here to help them do? Say it loud. Gain independence. Be able to self-regulate. We have to let them discover for themselves what it is they're able to do. And it's not just being stern. You know, it's not being nice. Does that make sense? So, when we have brain injury, any type of brain injury, where it's congenital, where they have a disability, or they have an acquired brain injury, there's a lot of things that goes on, okay? And it's different depending on what's happened to the student. Does anybody have students that have what's called TBI, traumatic brain injury, that something happened after they were born? Do you guys work with any students that are like that you know of? Nobody? Okay. So most of the students that we have are going to be over here on this left-hand side where there's congenital, where they were born with this disability. Is that right? Okay. Well, it doesn't matter whether or not they were born with a disability, or they acquired the disability after birth. Here are some very common things that happen to students with whether it's congenital or whether it happened to them through an accident. Number one is the reduced ability to plan and set goals. Number two is reduced ability to self-monitor, initiate, or inhibit. Number three is reduced problem-solving and flexibility. Number four is reduced ability to transfer and generalize learning. And number five is reduced abstract reasoning. Now that all happens in this frontal lobe. Okay? Now this is important to, I know it sounds very technical. I don't mean to get technical. I know it's easier to be emotional than it is technical. But you guys need to know where things happen in the brain, and I'm going to try to go through it as fast as I can. Now, when we move from the frontal lobe to the more temporal lobe, you have reduced memory, reduced learning efficiency, reduced emotional control, and then you have, sometimes you can have reduced information processing efficiency, reduced stamina. Do you guys see any of this in your students? This should be much different than typical student. Well, when we see all this, what we do is we try to get to this person-centered, context-sensitive, self-regulatory intervention. That's what you guys do. You may not realize or have called it that, but that's what you're doing. Because, let me see if I can explain it in a good way. We all suffer from this mind-body disconnect. Does that make sense? What keeps you from being able to lift 300 pounds? Does anybody know? Okay, sometimes it's your mind. Sometimes it's your body, right? But there's something that keeps you from lifting 300 pounds, right? Now, I lift 300 pounds every time I stand up. I'm like a Superman. But really, there's no way I would be able to bench press 300 pounds. I just wouldn't be able to do it today. Now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, I could probably do it once, have a heart attack, and die. But we all have these limitations, right? The students that we work with, they have the same limitations we do, but then they have trouble planning and setting goals. They have trouble self-monitoring what's going on inside of them. They have a reduced problem solving and flexibility of thinking. Do you see how all these factors kind of figure into what it is that we do? Now, that's all the technical part of this. The rest of it kind of goes more toward back to the emotional side, which everybody seems to like. But what we try to create are these person-centered, context-sensitive, self-regulatory interventions. And what this all means is that when you have a student that you know could do something, it is our responsibility to make sure they are doing what it is we know they can do. And if we let them lead us, we're not doing them the same service. Or we're not doing them the service that we could be doing for them. So how do we get the student to self-regulate and still be
independent
and still be, what's the first thing that we have to keep in mind?
Safe.
So who encounters trouble like this? Who encounters students that you know they can do more but seem to want to do less? Raise your hand if you have that. Okay. So that's most of us. So what do we do? Who hadn't talked yet? This guy right here. Tell me what you do when you have a student that you know can do more but won't.
Try to push them to do more.
Okay, so how do you do that?
Try to find out what they like. Try to make it fun for them or do it in a way that they might not even realize they're working toward a certain goal or something to get them to do it.
Okay, so when do you decide when to push?
Based on the person you watch, you observe.
How many of you have to deal with behavioral fits? Okay. So somebody describe a behavior that you've seen that you had trouble with. Okay. David, I love you. You're so participative. Everybody else is like, dude, man, it's 8 o'clock in the morning on Saturday morning. You're asking us all these questions.
Not getting out of bed.
Like what? I'm sorry.
Not getting out of bed.
Not getting out of bed. Okay, so you deal with a student that won't get out of bed.
Yeah, another thing that I do for my job.
Okay, all right, so what do you do when they won't get out of bed?
Right now my go-to is, I know they don't like place.
Okay.
And there's construction going on upstairs. So I just kind of rap on the wall a little bit until there's construction.
Oh, okay. All right. So is that effective?
It works, but I don't like doing it.
Okay. Well, it's you know, we got to get them out of bed, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So they have to get up, and they're not self-regulated enough to get up on their own.
Yeah.
Okay. So what could we do to help them get out of bed?
Try to set an alarm, have them set their alarm.
Okay, for them to take responsibility for.
Yeah, that still doesn't work because the alarm got tossed across the room.
Well, that's probably not all there. I do that.
Yeah, that's what I said. I can't really can't blame the person.
Right. In fact, my alarm perpetually lives behind my nightstand because I'll knock it off. But so what we want to get to is where these students push themselves, right? That's the area we want to get to. So this is where we come into this idea of self-regulation. And what you guys are telling me is that we do something until they seem like they don't like it, right? Is that fair to say for everybody? We do something until they seem like they don't like it. So that's kind of how we gauge whether or not we move to the next activity. But we have students that have trouble moving from one activity to the other because they don't transition well. Okay, so what do we do? How do we learn what a student can do and what a student can't do? How do we learn that? Okay, you can observe. What else can we do? Which is a good answer, yes.
I was trying to motivate them, so I'll be like, okay, we have to do sit-ups, and then we can go do something fun.
Right? Okay, once again, it goes back to this idea that first this, then that, okay? So it's that contingency. But those contingencies, you have to remember, are so important because that's how we self-regulate ourselves. What Brandon said and what David's been saying, what Sydney just said, is we have to get the student to the point to where, not like they're robots. Like, we don't want them just doing exactly what we say. And we want to make sure that what they're doing is enjoyable. Because if it's not enjoyable, they're not going to do it. But we have to have this idea of these clear contingencies. Because if you don't have a clear contingency, you can't get to what the student can do and what the student can't do. How many of you have seen students that couldn't do what you were asking them to do? Just absolutely could not do it. Okay, give me an example. Your name is?
Kate.
Kate. Okay, give me an example, Kate.
Well, my child can't actually walk yet, but
so asking them to walk is probably not a good idea.
Yeah, she walks, but she needs assistance. So
okay.
We at first thought we could work on her balance, but she can't walk yet, so we couldn't really take her walk.
How old is she?
She's 4.
Okay, so she's 4. So this is a really young child, which you have to treat a little bit differently than you do a student that's in later childhood, right? Which you have to treat a little bit differently than a child that's in early adolescence, which you have to treat differently from a child that's in late adolescence. You see how complicated it can be? So how have you worked with this child?
So it said we work on like just walking and like stepping over small things. So just kind of focus on like actually walking and not like walking a certain way.
Okay. All right. So you have a 4-year-old, and you're asking them to step over obstacles, right? Do they enjoy doing that?
No.
Okay, so what behavior do you get when they don't want to do that?
Just indifference.
Okay, yeah. Okay. So when you say indifference, they don't really tantrum.
No, she doesn't tantrum, but she really doesn't care. It's like sometimes it's hard to get her to step over the thing, but that's when you like really just try to like use positive.
All right. So how often do you ask her to step over something?
Like once a week.
Okay.
Like a few minutes at the end.
Okay. So she has to do it every week.
Yeah.
Okay. Which is very good. So you have her on some type of schedule that moves and All right, so what do you do before you ask her to step up her stuff?
Just whatever we're doing before.
Okay. Right, so you don't have a set of activities other than she has to step over things. So how does she do that without assistance?
Oh no, she does, but it's just part of like the different parts that go into walking is like seeing a different texture or color.
Sure.
And stepping onto or over it.
Okay, so like she'll step up a step.
Yeah, but her hands are held to some extent, so she's walking, but she's still like kind of using assistance, but it's a lot of like looking down and like processing.
Okay, so how would we treat a four-year-old different? Who works with somebody that's in later childhood, like a 9 or 10-year-old? Who does a 9 or 10-year-old? Tell me a challenge that you have with your 9 or 10-year-old.
I have a 14-year-old, and she has a hard time like walking as well.
Okay.
And she has a walker, or I need to like hold her hand, and I also try to do like balancing, that just doesn't work. She has a hard time balancing herself.
A little bit of fear.
A bit, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So she's a little afraid. She's a little, even with somebody holding her hands, she's afraid. So we just don't do the balance beam anymore?
No.
Okay, so what do we do instead of the balance beam?
We're working on her hand-eye coordination and like strengthening her legs and arms.
Okay, so we're strengthening to get balance, right? All right, as you're strengthening to get balance, guess what you're also working on? Self-regulation. Self-regulation. And the reason I want to point this out, because even the four-year-old is working on self-regulation. And you're getting, you know, if they don't want to do it, you say you get indifference, right? And now, I don't want to put words in your mouth, because you didn't say, you know, when she doesn't want to do it, she shows fear. When she doesn't want to do something, what does she do? Is it a she or a he?
She'll say stop.
She'll say stop. That's very good. That's very good. Do you listen to her?
No, I just like start singing a song,
so
she's gotta get her mind off
it. Okay, so we get to where we're pushing her. Excellent. So how do you know when you've pushed her too far?
When I see her start struggling, we'll take a break.
Okay, but you explain the struggle to me.
Like when I see that she has like gone like above like what I expected her to like be able to do, and then I see her like she has a hard time like catching her breath.
Uh-huh.
So then we'll just like
okay, yeah, because it's important to breathe. Breathing is important. They have to be able to breathe. So even though we have a four-year-old with similar problems, how do we get to where the four-year-old, by the time they become
14,
how do we get to where she doesn't need this same type of intervention? How do we determine that? What's the optimal thing that we would want to do with the four-year-old that we could change by the time they get to where they're 14? No ideas? With the four-year-old, we have a much greater window to teach self-regulation. And so this is why it's so important, because self-regulation, which is what you guys are doing, reduces aggression. That's aggressive right there. It also reduces impulsive behavior. Do you see any of your students have impulsive behavior? Some of your students, now it's not a case of this, not that they don't want to do, it's not that they don't want to do what you're asking them to do. They want to do everything, right? They want to do this, they want to do that, I want to do this, I want to do that, I want to do this, I want to do that. Especially if something is preferred. Oh, I want to do this, I want to do this, I want to do this, I want to do this. Impulsive behavior. Now, that's pretty impulsive right there. Could be repulsive too, because I think that's the dog's issue. Self-regulation also reduces socially awkward behavior. You have to keep in mind that the students that you're working with, how easy is it going to be for them to make the friends that you guys make? Easy or hard?
Hard.
Why?
They face difficulties in their regular life.
How?
Some people can't walk or talk some of the children.
Like we can. So.
It's challenging for them to make friends when they lack some certain things.
Which is one reason we want to make sure that we're pushing them as far as they can go without getting some of the behaviors that we get, which you still have to pay attention to what they're telling you with body language. But at the same time, if you set up these contingencies like Brandon is talking about, first this, then that, that's how we push. And in doing that, we teach this idea of self-regulation. Because what you don't want them to have is this: impaired judgment. And, you know, you don't want just terrible ideas to begin with. But these are the things that they face. Self-regulation is what helps even children with special needs start to have this reasoning ability that sometimes seems to escape them. So this is another problem, too: delayed gratification. I'm trying to wake you guys up. I'm almost out of pictures. She's like, oh my God, this is fun. So, all right. So self-regulation and supporting individuals in the development of self-regulatory behaviors cannot be implemented as standalone or an independent curriculum separate from academics. Self-regulation supports academics, is integral to academic success, and is foundational to effective teaching and learning. Now, what you do is not academics, but what you can substitute is, if we said self-regulation and supporting individuals in the development of self-regulatory behaviors cannot be implemented as a standalone or independent curriculum separate from moving, from physical ability. Self-regulation supports physical ability, is integral to physical success, and is foundational to effective social and emotional development, self-regulatory behavior. You have to keep in mind that as you push them, you have to push them toward this idea of self-regulation. And when you do that, Jill, you set up the contingencies, first this and then that, and then you get to do more of what you know they need instead of the things that are fun. What do most of our students find fun? How many of you would say the things that they find fun are the things that they seem to do well? So, but we can't just ask them to do what they can do well, right? Am I wrong about that? So we have to keep this idea of, as we challenge them to do more through contingencies, through our first this, then something fun, right? As we keep in mind these contingencies, we're not just working with them physically. We're not just getting them to make a basket. We're not just getting them to do the balance beam. We're not just getting them to step over objects or step up on a step. We're teaching them how to self-regulate so that we can avoid things like this. What you do is so important with these students. So what this is it kind of takes on a conceptual shift. Now here, teaching skills are increasing knowledge to develop competence in the use of skills and knowledge. So once again, if we take out the word academic, what would you call what you do with the CPDC? If it's not academic, what is it? Okay, so it's physical. It's physical. How many of you work with students with autism? So students with autism typically, now every student can be different, typically have different physical abilities than students. How many of you work with students with cerebral palsy? Okay, so what's the difference? So you have cerebral thing, Dave. Is it autism and cerebral palsy, or is
no,
it?
No, also my job.
Okay, so you work, you obviously work somewhere where you work with children with disabilities all day long, okay? So what's the difference between somebody with autism and somebody with cerebral palsy?
Cerebral palsy is more affected by
affects more of what you do, but it doesn't matter because even though the student with autism may be able to do more physical, they have different limitations than students that actually have physical limitations. But what we tend to see is all children with disabilities tend to face these types of things. All right, so my time is up. So I have to wind this down, but let me tell you a quick story before I end this. When we first adopted Toby and his older brother, Tim, my wife was a special educator. My wife was a special educator. So she had a really, really, really good idea about what Toby could do. In fact, I was really hesitant on adopting Toby. Now, he's been with me for too long now. He's my son. But I was really hesitant because all I saw was what he could do then. He couldn't walk, barely walk, could not talk at all, could not say words. All he would do, and this, when I say all he would do, this is what he would do. We put him in this donut walker wheels kind of thing, and he would do this. He was walking the walker, boom, hit a wall, turn around. Boom, hit a wall, turn around. Boom, hit a wall, turn around. I'm not kidding. And when he put a hole in this wall, he just moved to the left. That's true. That's all he would do. And he did that for hours on end. For hours on end. We'd pick him up, hold him, and he didn't mind being held. But as soon as you put him back in that walker, boom, 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 that's what he did. He couldn't say words, and we worked with him forever to try to say words. He would walk, and there was this gate. And at first, I was really afraid to push him. It scared me, because all I could see was what he was then. Does that make sense? But I learned that the way to get him to do things was to find things he really liked to do, like those things that our students find so easy to do. And I would let him do those things, but he had to do the hard stuff that I needed him to do first. First this, then that. And you can't believe the miracles that that works. Because remember, Toby has autism, cerebral palsy, it's spinal bifida. Didn't talk until he was five. Didn't say words until he was five. Couldn't say sentences until he was eight. Couldn't talk in complete sentences until he was eight. Toby, come here. All right, turn around. Tell him what your name is and when your birthday is.
Toby Cash, April 30th.
What year were you born?
2001.
Where do you live?
Boxborough.
Where you go to school?
West Bridgewater.
What's your teacher's name?
Buddy Hicks.
What's your favorite subject?
Science and history.
What's the last grade you made on your history test?
I don't know. Wait, 90.
90, okay. You go back and have a seat. If we only see our students where they are when we have them, we miss this vision because there's a lot of hard work here. Not on my part, on his part. I had the easy job. All I had to do was know what I needed him to do. Does that make sense? And I want to leave you with this one last thought. You may be, and I said this earlier, you may be the only person in the child's life you're working with that are asking them to do anything. So when you get blowback, you have to know how to deal with it, but you have to push it. Don't be afraid to first be safe, but to second, push the students that you work with. Expect that you're going to get some behavior because you're asking them to do something that's very hard for them to do. If you ask me to go out and run a mile, there's all kind of things you would hear come out of my mouth. They wouldn't be pretty. I may question your lineage. I would say terrible things about your mother that nobody has ever said. I would. But don't you think I need to go out and run a mile? I'm working on it. You do. You really do. So before we end, do I have any final questions? You've been a really great audience. I know I cannot imagine being a college student and being somewhere at 8 o'clock on Saturday morning. I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart as somebody that has a child with a disability. I cannot tell you how important you are. Not everybody will do what it is you do. Not everybody will care as much as you care. So I know it's hard to get up. I know sometimes you feel like you're not doing as much as you could be doing, but you're doing a lot. Keep in mind that you're not just asking them to do physical things, you are teaching them self-regulation. And in teaching them self-regulation, you know that when we talked about how not having friends, you know, you can just look down the line and say, you know, it's going to be really hard for them to have friends because they're so different. The more you do with them today, the easier it's going to be for them to fit in to the world that you and I create. And that's what they have to do. So thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate that.